and uncertain, we stumbled. Our wandering feet, searching blindly for the path. But you spoke light into our darkness. In our weakness, you gave us strength. In our sorrow, you placed peace within us and set our eyes upon your promise. For you have called us out of darkness and into your marvelous light.
Good morning. How are you guys? Yeah. Quiet bunch this morning. Well, what is up with this weather, right? It's the middle of February, and the forecast for today has temperatures of over 70 degrees. That's weird. Ridiculous. Anyway, you might be asking yourself, what is this contraption that I have on my head? We're just going to ignore that for now. We'll get to that in just a second. We are in week two of our Out of the Shadows series. We're looking at how we can walk in the light when there's darkness in our past, when there's darkness around us. Last week, Michael spoke about the tug of war that we feel as believers. As children of light, our spirits delight in serving God and pleasing God, but our flesh still wants what it's always wanted, right? It wants to serve itself. So there's this tension there. We looked at, how do we make sense of that? What do we do with that? Some of you guys are still looking at this thing. Anyway, so we said, what do? We take responsibility for our sin, but we don't internalize it as our identity. We remind ourselves of who God says we are, and we lean into him to teach us how to live that out. Well, if you missed out, it's on the website. Go and check it out. This week, we're talking about how the gospel helps us see everything in a new way. Here we go. You ready for this? In a world full of darkness, the gospel gives us night vision. Ta-da! That's the big reveal. Clap or something. Thank you. I was going to feel really awkward there for a minute. I'm going to take these off. I think these are worth more than my car. So the gospel gives us night vision in a world full of darkness. As we start this conversation, it's kind of interesting to note that two people can be looking at the same thing, but see something very different from each other, something quite unique. So I've got an example for us. Now we remember this little beauty from all of the online frenzy that it caused over what color this dress actually is. So I've got to know, when you look at this picture, raise your hand if you see a white and gold dress. Okay, I'm going to count myself with you guys. I've always seen a white and gold dress. You can put your hands down. Raise your hand if you see a black and blue dress. All right, put your hands down. Isn't that weird? We legitimately see two different things, and we're looking at the same picture. The problem is, this is either a picture of a white and gold dress in shadow, or it's a black and blue dress that's been washed out by a really bright light. And our brains don't have enough context from this picture to make a definitive determination. So our brains just pick one. And so some people's brains pick white and gold, and others pick black and blue. But if we look at the next picture, dun, 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 we see that the dress is actually black and blue. How can we tell that? Because in this picture, we have context. Up against the white wedding dress, it's clear to us what color that dress actually is. So those of us that wrongly saw white and gold can now see it for what it really is. As Christians, Jesus is that white wedding dress that helps us see everything else as it really is. Not just our perspective or our best guess. He helps us to see it for what it really is. The gospel is the context through which we see the rest of the world. And this applies to everything, absolutely everything. But for today, we're going to focus in on how it impacts the way we see people. The way we see other people and the way we see ourselves. We need to see people the way God sees people. So, how does God see people? Well, that's why I love our passage for today. Today we are in 2 Corinthians 5, 16 to 21. And before we jump right into our passage, there are some context pieces that we need about 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians is a book that's made up of two letters put together. These are actually the third and fourth letters that Paul has written to the church at Corinth. And in the letter that he wrote just before this, what we call 1 Corinthians, he's writing to a jacked up church. We got all kinds of issues going on. We've got guys who are sleeping with their stepmom, lots of disgusting dysfunction and problems here. But in this letter, 2 Corinthians, written just a few short years later, we can see that a dramatic transformation has taken place. These guys are back on track. Paul is celebrating. And by the time he comes to chapter 5, verse 14 and 15, he's doing a quick flyover of the gospel. Verse 14, he says, "For the love of Christ controls us, because we have concluded this, that one has died for all, therefore all have died. And he died for all, that those who live might no longer live for themselves, but for him who for their sake died and was raised." What he's saying is, as Christians, we share in the death of Christ. And so we don't live for ourselves anymore. We live for him. We're not out to please ourselves. We're out to please him. And so the verses that follow make up our passage for today. And they start to explore what that looks like, describing what it looks like to live for Jesus. So let's jump in, verse 16. "From now on," these words signal that there's a big change taking place. "From now on, therefore, we regard no one according to the flesh. Even though we once regarded Christ according to the flesh, we regard him thus no longer." He jumps in and says, hey, as we start this conversation of what it looks like to live for Jesus, something that's very foundational here is the way we see people. We've got to stop seeing people according to the flesh, according to the world standard. We tried to use that standard on Jesus, and it didn't work. He did not fit the bill of what we thought an important person should look like. And he was the Messiah. We didn't see it coming. From now on, if we're going to live for Christ, this changes, this whole framework. So what does it mean to regard someone according to the flesh? Let's unpack that just a little bit. When we see through the lens of the flesh, what we're seeing is superficial. Right? We're looking at things on the outside. We're making evaluations about people based on things like their appearance. Are they attractive? Do they look cool? Do they look interesting? Do they look rich? Do they look smart? Things like age. Are they young and energetic or older and wiser? Are they immature or experienced? We're looking at things like their social circle and connectedness. We're considering things like race and gender and wealth, things like career. We see this reflected in some of the ridiculous job titles people have now. I was reading a short article about how paper boys in the UK are now being referred to as media delivery officers. Why do we do things like that? Because we know people are using this stuff to make judgments about our value. The lens of the flesh is also self-serving. We value people based on what they can do for us, right? Can you help me get something that I want? This is something that I struggled with at times. In 2010, after I came back from Hollywood Week on American Idol, I moved to Nashville to pursue a music career. And when I lived in Nashville, there was this church that was known to be loaded with music industry people, right? Now, bear in mind, Nashville is a city that is full of aspiring musicians, so there's this clamoring for attention from anyone who can help you launch your career, and it's this mindset, and it was my mindset. So there's this church that is known to be loaded with all of these industry people. We've got record label people, big producers and songwriters and artists from Hillsong and Word, and so naturally I had to go, right? So I start going to this church a couple times, and from the moment I walk in, I'm looking for that seat next to the big name producer, hoping that maybe during worship I can sing a little riff that'll get someone's attention, you know? And of course, I had to stay afterward for fellowship with all of the influential music business people, right? When it occurred to me what I was doing, it made me sick. But that's our default when we're looking through the lens of the flesh. We're looking at people and valuing them based on what they can give us, what they can do for us. We're self-serving. What else? The lens of the flesh is judgmental. When we're looking at people through the lens of the flesh, we tend to define them by their performance, by their actions, by their mistakes. I'll throw out a couple names to make my point. Bill Cosby, Lance Armstrong. Their scandals are the first things that come to mind. As a culture, we blacklist these people. And many of us see the same thing reflected in our personal lives, at the office or in our social circle. So before we know Jesus, this is a part of how we see the world to varying degrees with different people, but it all kind of comes out one way or another. But when he came, he completely defied all of our standards and rules about value. And what Paul is telling us is that if we're going to live for him, we got to see people the way he sees them, the way he did. So what does that look like? Well, lucky for us, when we look at the Gospels, we've got lots of great examples. Jesus' lenses are impartial. Time and time again, what do we see? We see Jesus going out of his way to reach out to people who have been outcasted by their society. He baffled secular culture and the religious establishment when he repeatedly chose to hang out with nobodies, right? And not just nobodies, despised people. Crowds of people swarmed him, and yet we see him stopping everything to deal with the needs of who? A blind beggar. We see him reaching out and touching the untouchable, lepers, healing them. In the kingdom of God, there is no Jew or Greek, slave or free, male or female. There is unity and impartiality. The lens of Jesus is also humble. We see the Son of God. Can we get our minds around that? Coming down and washing feet. It's something that we hear a lot, so the shock of it is worn off a little bit, but it is remarkable. We see Jesus talking about what it looks like to be great in his kingdom. And he says, the powers of this world, they seek power and authority so that they can lord it over you, so that they can exert force over you. But what it means to be great, to rule in my kingdom, it means that you're a servant of all. For the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. He sought to serve. How might that change our relationships, our friendships, our marriages, if we stop focusing on what we want and start asking ourselves, how can I give? How can I serve? Jesus' lenses are humble. Jesus' lenses are also compassionate. I want to highlight that part of verse 19. Not counting their trespasses against them. That's not to say that Jesus didn't take sin seriously. He did, and he does. But he didn't come to rain down condemnation on sinners. Instead, we see him treating sinners not so much as evil as sick, in need of a healer. When I think about Jesus' ministry, honestly, compassion is one of the biggest words that comes to mind. He didn't let people's sin keep him from reaching out to them. He didn't just see the sin. He saw the pain and the hurt and the brokenness behind the sin. And he saw it as a place where he could minister and bring healing. He saw the woman at the well, and he didn't just see an adulterer. He saw a woman that bore the brokenness of countless failed relationships. He saw a person that felt the pain of being rejected by her community. This woman who carried so much shame that she came to draw water in the heat of the day when no one else was around. Jesus goes out of his way to give her his attention, to engage her in conversation. He doesn't look at her with judgment, but he looks at her with mercy and dignity and compassion. In another story from the Gospels, Jesus is surrounded by a crowd of people, and he says, "Who touched me?" Right? And the disciples are like, "What do you mean, who touched you? People are pressing up against you on every side. What are you talking about?" And it's the woman with the issue of blood. And he stops everything, and he turns to her and shares a tender moment with her and heals her, turning away from the chaos of the crowd to deal with her. In the midst of all of that, the crowd of people, he sees the individual. That's how we've got to see. Matthew 9:36 tells us that Jesus looked out on the crowds and describes what he saw. Who does it say that he sees? A bunch of punks that rejected him? No. It says that he saw people with compassion, harassed, helpless, hopeless, sheep without a shepherd. He saw people who were thirsting for peace and purpose. He saw people in need of a Savior, and his heart longed to save them. In Luke 19, it says that his heart wept over them if they would have only known what would bring them peace. That's how we're called to see people. So I ask this question. Will you allow God to give you new lenses? Will you see people differently not as the world sees, but as Jesus sees people. God's word is good news to people who feel like they don't measure up to the world's standard. He didn't see people that way, and as Christians, neither do we. Now, it's important for us to realize that this new way of seeing with the eyes of the Spirit, it's not something that we do on our own, right? It happens by the work of God in us. It's just like verse 18 says, all this is from God. But we're going to shift gears here a little bit, because our passage for today is not just reshaping the way we see other people. It's also telling us something about the way that we should see ourselves. So let's look at verses 18 to 20. All this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting to us the message of reconciliation. Pay attention here. Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ, God making his appeal through us. We implore you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. He's saying, whoever you thought you were, God is saying, no. You're not just a teacher. You're not just someone that works at ISIN. You're not just a coal miner or a receptionist or a server at O'Charlie's. You are an ambassador of the Most High. We really need to get this, because this is huge. When we get our vision corrected, when we start seeing people the right way, it positions us for this new job that we have in Christ, the job of ambassador. I don't know how many of you know this, but being an ambassador is a pretty important job, right? Last time I taught you that family language isn't throwaway language. I taught you to call each other brother so-and-so and sister so-and-so. This week I'm teaching you to call each other ambassador so-and-so. So what does an ambassador do, right? An ambassador represents their king. They're sent somewhere to represent their government. They know that everything they say and do, that it all reflects on their government. How would you act if you were sent somewhere as an ambassador for the United States? How would you feel? Humbled and honored? How would you dress? Probably wear your favorite tie. How would you act? You'd make sure that every move you made reflected well on your nation, because you knew you represent your nation. You'd probably look back on the conversations from your day and say, and did I talk too much? Should I have told that joke I told? You take it seriously because you know that your job is important. And what would be your goal? To win friends for your nation, to further the purposes of your nation. Hear me. You don't just go to work. You are sent to work as an ambassador for Christ. You don't just go to school. You are sent to school as an ambassador for Christ. That changes everything. So an ambassador represents their king, but they also carry their king's message. They're given a measure of authority to speak on behalf of their king. We have been entrusted with the message of reconciliation. As Christians, that's the gospel. This dividing wall of hostility that existed between God and man because of our sin, it's been torn down because of Jesus. He made a way for us to have relationship with God again through faith in him. In our reconciliation to God, we're rejoined with the source of all life and healing. Everything that's broken in our lives finds its restoration. Our spirits, our bodies, our relationships. And it's given to us freely. As Christians, we're given the joy-filled job of inviting people into that. As ambassadors, we're commissioned to further the interests of the kingdom. So how do we further the interests of the kingdom? We make more friends for our king. And the good news is that he wants to be our friend, no matter what we've done. He wants to be our friend. We get to welcome people into this new kingdom and family. And it's like we talked about earlier, we're not looking for the best looking, best dressed, wealthiest, most influential, most respected people. This is the whole point of what Jesus came to the earth to do, to redeem us. And God says, we have a role to play in that. Isn't that crazy? And it's an important role. He makes his appeal through us. The Holy Spirit speaks through us and calls to the hearts of men saying, come, be reconciled to God. You who are broken, you who are harassed, you who are lost, you who are sinners, come, be reconciled. Jesus speaks through us and says, if you're thirsty, come and drink of my living water. This is how God has chosen to work, through us. What I really want us to get from this is that we have a purpose. We got a job to do. And it's an important, meaningful, consequential one. So I ask you, Christians, this question. Will you embrace the joy-filled job of being an ambassador for his kingdom? Sharing the good news that God wants to be your friend and your king. He has paid the price for citizenship in his kingdom. Will you be a minister of reconciliation in the place that he's put you, in your family, at your job, in your community? Out of the shadows, in a world full of darkness, how do we have night vision? How do we see with clarity? I'm going to read a story for you. It's about a woman named Patty Wetterling, and I think it'll give us some insight. On the 22nd of October, 1989, Jacob Wetterling was kidnapped just a mile away from his home. He was 11 years old at the time. For 27 years, his mother and father, Patty and Jerry Wetterling, didn't know what had become of their son. But in September of 2016, they learned that he had been raped and shot and killed mere hours after he was abducted and buried less than an hour away from his home. In the aftermath of this shocking discovery, Patty met the mother of another victim, Christian woman that challenged her to see with God's eyes. Patty gave this message just after the man who kidnapped Jacob, the man she pleaded with for years to tell her where her son was sentenced. She said, what I really wanted to say today is about Jacob. He's taught us all how to live, how to love, how to be fair, how to be kind. I want to say to Jacob, I'm so sorry. It's incredibly painful to know what happened in your last days, your last hours, your last minutes. We love you, Jacob. will continue to fight. There's a lot more work to do to protect all of our world's children. Many of us would turn to hate, choosing to show no mercy to someone who hurt us so deeply. But that's not Patty. Visiting sex offenders in prison, decades later, and even after finding out the terrible fate of her son, she says this of those offenders who commit similar crimes. I want them to see a personal side. I want to show them a compassionate side. Patty could have allowed the pain she felt to make her harder. No one would blame her. She could be calling for justice, demanding the harshest possible punishments for such criminals, and she would be right to do so. Instead, she allowed herself to become compassionate. She didn't lie about her pain. The devastating knowledge that she was not able to protect her child and that she didn't know where he was. But Patty's soft heart has encouraged her to do the hard work of extending compassion both to children who have been victimized as well as to the criminals who have committed those crimes. Her tireless work to love the unlovable has made our children safer and the world a brighter place. Wow. How do we see other people? How do we view ourselves? By the power of God, we see with new eyes, the eyes of the Spirit. Will you allow God to give you new lenses? Will you see people differently, not as the world sees, but as Jesus sees people? Will you embrace the joy-filled job of being an ambassador for his kingdom, sharing the good news that God wants to be your friend and your king? If you're in the room and you don't know Jesus, this stuff we've been talking about today is how God sees you with incredible love and compassion. Verse 21, the last verse in our passage for today, says, "For our sake, he made him to be sin who knew no sin, that in him we might become the righteousness of God." Jesus paid the price for you to be made right with God. So as his ambassador, I implore you, I invite you, be reconciled to God. Don't miss this opportunity. Let's pray together. Holy Spirit, we thank you for your word. We thank you for how your Holy Spirit brings that word to life, and that it's powerful and active to change us, to change our hearts. We ask today that you would give us a new prescription, that you would help us to see in a new way, to see people with compassion the way that you saw them. I'm reminded of the picture of Jesus hanging on the cross, being brutally murdered. And what do we see him doing? We see him praying for the forgiveness of the people that are murdering him. A radical compassion that blows our minds. God, I pray that you would birth that in your people. Help us to love people in spite of what we see on the outside, in spite of what they do and say, in spite of what they've done to us. Maybe they've hurt us. Help us to love them bigger than that, to see them with compassion that is bigger than that, as we seek to follow you, Jesus, as we seek to live for you. Give us a heart for the people around us, for Southern Illinois, that's bigger than anything they've done wrong. In the darkness around us, let us carry the light. God, let your church in Southern Illinois rise up and stand into that role, that job of being ambassadors, carrying the truth and the message of reconciliation, that no matter what somebody has done, that you paid for them to be made right with you. You paid the penalty. Help us to see ourselves in a new way and to take that job seriously. Empower us by the Holy Spirit. Fill us up with the Holy Spirit to do that work, God. Show yourself strong in us. Go before us. Prepare a harvest for us. We ask all of these things in the name of your precious Son, Jesus. Amen.